There is a King seated among us. Let every heart receive Him now. Where there is praise, He will inhabit. There will be grace and mercy all around. Every burden will be lifted in His presence. Every trophy will be laid down at His feet. There is a name that reigns above all others. Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. Unto the Lamb, honor and glory, worthy is He who overcame. Buried in shame, risen in power, He is alive and stone is rolled away. Worship will belong to Him forever. Death is conquered, and our Savior holds the keys. There is a name that reigns above all others. Jesus Christ, the King above all kings.
Sing He Lives. If everybody could please stand.
I see. serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I see His voice of cheer. In just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian. Lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. The hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Dear God, we just lift up this time again. We just get to praise You today. Thank You for what You've done for us. Thank You for rolling the stone away and taking our sins away, too. Just bless our time. Thank You for everyone here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning. I'm going to go over what we have coming up this week. With it being Resurrection Sunday, we're glad to have you here this morning, but we will not be meeting tonight, so make sure that you are spending that time with your family. Also, Ring of Fire is coming up this Wednesday, which is what our church does for our youth. It's at 6:30 right here in the same building. We serve dinner, so feel free to come. Also, this coming Saturday, one of our youth has graduated high. He's on this side. One of our youth graduated high school, so his open house, his address, and the time. It's from 1 to 4 this Saturday. Feel free to come out there. There will be pulled pork and food, and just a good time to come out and celebrate that. And then we have a vacation Bible school coming up rather quickly. It's June 4th through the 8th, and we have our first vacation. Bible school planning meeting this Thursday at 6:30, 6:30, this Thursday at 6:30 up here. So if you're wanting to help with VBS in any way, whether it's decorating or helping contribute supplies or coming up and teaching the kids or maybe just playing with the kids, any way that you would like to help, or maybe you just thinking you might want to try to make it to that meeting, and we're just going to start digging in and figuring out what all is going to be going on with that this year. And I believe that is all the announcements that I have. We're going to be watching the Vacation Bible School video as soon as I'm done with announcements. That'll kind of help you guys understand a little bit more about what the theme is and what we're doing. Do we have any birthdays that we're celebrating? Any anniversaries? No? All right, we'll get that video started then.
Light, darkness, good, evil, truth, lies. We are engaged in an epic battle between two spiritual kingdoms for the hearts and minds of our youth. Every day, our kids are bombarded with lies about who they are, who their creator is, what is right, and where their salvation comes from. But we are not meant to fight this battle alone. God, the ruler of the good kingdom, has given his kingdom keepers spiritual armor to wear. With this VBS, your kids will learn how they can be a part of God's kingdom through salvation in his Son, and they will be equipped with the armor of God as they train to become keepers of the kingdom who stand strong in today's battle for truth. Huzzah!
For the next song, we're going to sing Christ is Risen by Matt Maher.
From the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come. Time for prayer. So what I want to do is just give you a couple of names, and if you've got one, if you quickly can give that to us, and then we'll take a moment in prayer. Everybody knows how it works. We begin to pray. I'm just going to kneel down here, and it's just going to be quiet for a minute or two. You pray, and then I'll close it out in just a couple of minutes. Prayer must become part of the foundation of our church. Prayer for VBS, Vacation Bible School, is one of the outreaches we do as a church. In case you didn't catch on the video, it's Keepers of the Kingdom. We're going to teach the kids the armor of God. Boy Lawson is home, recovering. He has home health nurse. I don't really know much else than that. Good. He's hungry. Good. Leanne and Terry are traveling today. Pray for her dad, Colburn Schrock, who had surgery. Where is she? Well, she's in there. And that's about what I know there. And some maybe got this. It came late at night. Jonathan Eppert. He's a 13-year-old young man. Several of you know the Epperts. Had blood in his urine and was out at Children's Mercy for a night. And he's home, and they're going to run some more tests, I guess. So that's the ones that I am very, that jumped out at me this morning that I've just scribbled down. Be in prayer for the church. Always, always be in prayer for the church. Yes, Margaret. Okay. Okay. Lisa.
Christy and Jeremy at Emerson. I mentioned Christy a couple of weeks ago. Cancer spreads to the liver and lungs.
I think I had her down as colon cancer to begin with. Christy Emerson, did I get it right?
Yes.
Okay.
Jeremiah's her husband.
Okay. All right. Somebody else. Rosemary.
I'm Joe Crook, who was preaching at Austin Baptist Church. He has been in the hospital recently with pneumonia, and now he has congestive heart failure.
Okay. Joe Crook. Okay.
But he is home.
Congestive heart, pneumonia, recovery, home. Okay. Okay. Yes.
My mom's
for hip surgery? What did they do? Is it a replacement or was it just repair? Or? It was a replacement. Okay. What's her name?
Kathy.
I didn't have that down. Okay. Yes?
A friend of mine, David Jackson, who lives in North Kansas City.
Uh-huh.
She's always had problems with the thickening of the blood. It's something she inherited. The 27th of this month, she goes in for a heart cath. I'm not sure what they're going to do, but she's had other surgeries in the past for this. We used to work together. She is not born again, but she will call me because she knows when she tells me what's going on, but I tell her I will pray for her.
Okay. What was her first name?
Daza, D-A-T-H-A, Jackson. And my friend, Ed Pulliam, lives down at Forsyth. He was in the hospital Thursday and Friday. They let him go home yesterday. He's had another heart attack. Not real bad, but they have told him
he
has 12 stents and he's had two bypass surgeries. They've told him he'll be 60 on the 19th. They've told him there's nothing more we can do for you.
Oh.
But he is born again, and I keep telling him to trust God, you know. So they had all that storm warnings here a couple weeks ago, a week ago, and he panics. And I keep telling him, when are you going to start trusting God?
It's hard to do.
But he calls me all the time, and he now refers to me as his private counselor.
It's a calling. There you go. Anybody else? All right. I won't remember them all as we pray. I write them down. I'll get them on the list. But for Christy and Jeremiah, Emerson, Ed Pulliam, is it Datha Jackson? Okay, I got it right. Joe Crook, Kathy, Brian's mom, recovering from surgery, Laura Henry, PET scan, Jonathan Eppert, Colburn Schrock, Boy Lawson, VBS. I hope I got most of those right. Okay. All right, we're going to spend a moment in prayer. The expectation is that you will pray. As we pray quietly for about a minute, and then I will join you. Okay? So let's take a moment and seek the face of our God. Father, your word is clear. It says, the just shall live by faith. Our hope is in you. We have so many of the unknowns. Laura Henry and the PET scan don't know the results. And that weighs on our minds and hearts. The just shall live by faith. We ask for your intervention. Fred Pulliam, it almost sounds like I know we all live day by day, but he literally is living day by day. We shall live by faith. For Christy Emerson and her husband, Jeremiah. Courage and faith to face this, what seems like an insurmountable mountain that, Father, you help them conquer. I don't know what victory will look like for them, but I know part of it is trusting you. For Joe Crook, Father, continued healing and, you know, just the ability to breathe sometime. Congestive heart, pneumonia, and all those things work together. So I'd ask, Lord, you would clear his lungs. Thank you, Father, for Brian's mom and the recovery from the surgery. Thank you, Father, for young Jonathan Eppert, who's returned back home. Thank you, Father, for Colburn Schrock and the successful surgery and, of course, the good news of boy up and about. Father, my prayer when I knelt here that this not be just a moment, an exercise that means nothing to us, but it's a moment, God, where we call upon your name and ask for your holy presence to be with us, to assure us of your faithfulness and the comfort that you bring. That, Father, as we worship, as we teach your word, that, Father, we are changed. We are going to leave different than when we came in. Our hearts are going to be drawn to you. That is our goal, to be more like Christ than when we walked in. A little less like us and a little bit more like Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. And as I pray, Lord, it's not just Abiding Love Baptist. It's churches all over this nation that are gathering today to say he is risen. And that, Father, that power, that knowledge, Father, compels us to take a stand for Christ and to share the good news of Jesus with others. Empower your church this day. Empower us. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
All right, for offertory, we're going to sing Ain't No Grave. If everybody could please stand.
Christ is offertory, right?
Christ is risen.
Oh, I'm sorry. Christ arose.
Low in the grave, Jesus, my Savior, waiting the coming day, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he rose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark darkness, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. Arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. His bed, Jesus, my Savior. Vainly they seal the dead, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose. Savior, He tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord, up from the grave He arose, with a mighty triumph for His foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and He lives forever with His saints to reign. He arose, He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose.
Father God, first we want to thank You for being here with us today. And also to thank You for the group we have here today. We've got some visitors. And I don't know, I couldn't hardly count that high. But anyways, thank You very much for being here with us. We ask You to be with the pastor as he brings us a message. And I sneak one in there for myself. I want to thank You for helping me get my yards done this week. It was a great feeling to get back on the mower. And Lord, please accept this offering and guide us in its use. And Lord, please help us to be what You want us to be. We ask this in Your holy name. Amen.
All right, for today's worship song, we're going to sing Ain't No Grave.
Oh, shame is a prison as cruel as the grave. Shame is a robber, and he's come to take my name. Oh, love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power when my freedom song is found. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, gonna rise up out of the ground. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Liar with a stealing velvet tongue. Fear is a tyrant, he's always telling me to run. Oh, love is a resurrection, and love is a trumpet sound. Love is my weapon, gonna take my giants down. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, gonna hold my body down. Oh, there was a battle, a war between death and life. And there on a tree, the Lamb of God was crucified. And he went on down to hell, and he took back every key. He rose up as a lion, and he set up captives free. There ain't no grave gonna hold his body down.
Wow, that's the second time this month I died and went to Branson. That was, wow, that was good, gentlemen. That really was. I was sitting over thinking, I'm thinking, well, I'm ready to go home now. I love that. Put that back on the top 10 here. Get it back out. Today is what? It's Resurrection Sunday. I know some use that other word. I do on occasion, but I try and avoid it. I have reasons. Resurrection. And that's the top there. It's pretty simple. It's about Jesus. It's about Jesus. That's what it's about. So, you know, we'll get to a place where in here in the message, well, what does it mean to me or whatever, but it's about Jesus. And sometimes I like to, you know, and every pastor does, like to tell a story or something like that, or try and to add a little to the scripture or something just to make a point. But sometimes the Holy Spirit just says to me, just tell the story. Just tell the story. It's amazing all by itself, preacher. You don't need to put salt and pepper on it, all right? So here we go. All four Gospels tell the story. I'm just going to do some out of Mark, and we'll just jump in. It is a real story. This is history. I don't know if anybody pays any attention to technology that's going on in the world. But there's this chat GPT. Did I get it right? Okay. And what they did, this is just my little brain's imagination of it. But they're taking every piece of information that we have in the world and they're going to put it in this computer so it will answer every question you've ever had about anything. And I saw this morning that they asked the computer, ChatGPT, is the story of the resurrection of Christ true? Actually, it did a pretty good job of avoiding the real answer. But it did say historically, Jesus was a real person. We know that from different writings. We know that he died. We know that people like Pilate that's in the story and Herod were real people. But it did not ever make the claim that he died and rose again. It was a lot of, there are writings, but it says, as a computer, I cannot tell you about faith. Isn't that amazing? Computers cannot tell you about faith. I'm going to guess they can't tell you about joy, peace, and love either. They can give you data, statistics, stories, history, but they can't reach into the heart of a human. They can't. That comes from the Holy Spirit of God. So I thought that was interesting. And of course, they're promoting their knowledge, of course, today, like it's going to change anything. I just thought that was interesting. All right, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all tell the story of the resurrection. The obvious thing, that is the most important thing in our faith. Mark, they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him. We're not going to go into a big, long description about crucifixion, all right? Nails in the palms, nails in the wrist, I've read both. Nails to his feet. He'd already, of course, had been whipped. He'd already had the crown of thorns on his head. He was exhausted, beaten, spit upon, all those things, and then nailed to a cross. And then stood it in the ground. And then the idea is you will eventually suffocate because you cannot hold yourself up for very long. It's a horrible death. And they crucified him, dividing up his clothes. They cast lots to see what each one would get. It was 9 in the morning when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. We're going to skip down in the story, down to verse 34. And at 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And when some of those standing near heard this, they said, "He's calling for Elijah." Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it Jesus to drink. They said, "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Now let's go down to Mark a little farther. So what we've decided, with the help now of ChatGPT and other writings throughout the years, this is a real person. This is a real historical fact. So Joseph, and we're not going to go into the whole story of Joseph of Arimathea. Joseph bought some fine linen cloth, took down the body of Jesus, wrapped him in the linen, and placed him in a tomb cut out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. We all know that story. There's a little picture there. They would roll the stone across. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where he was laid. And I don't, you know, you kind of want to be careful here and not stir emotions and all that. But we've all been there. We've been to that place, and it's called a cemetery, and you've been there, and your loved one is there. And it says, and they saw where they laid him. The emotion. This was a real person. This was, for Mary, it's my son. For the others, it's those that followed. He was supposed to be the Messiah. He was supposed to save us. He was supposed to take out the Romans that are over us. How many hopes and dreams do you think just died right there? But wait a minute. Look at, I only picked out about 8 or 10 there. There are dozens of scriptures predicting Jesus' birth and life. Isaiah 7:14, born of a virgin. Genesis 22, the seed of Abraham. We know what family lineage he's going to come through. We even know what tribe they were in. There were 12 tribes. He came out of the tribe of Judah. We know that from Genesis 49. Family of Jesse. That's David. All right. Then keep moving through it. You go to the house of David. He was born in Bethlehem. He preexisted before time began. And he shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. All of those things were true and many, many more. And they knew those scriptures. And now it's over. It's done. We had all of this pointing forward, all of our hope. If you're a horse racer, we bet all our money on this horse. Died. It's over. And we get there from time to time in our lives, and it's over. And the dream dies. The vision dies. The person leaves. But we need to keep our eyes on the things that he had said. And he had told them on at least 3 different occasions. We're going to Jerusalem. I will be persecuted. I will be beaten. I will be crucified. And I will what? Be raised on the 3rd day. They forgot that part at this point. And they were distraught. But our faith must remain in Christ no matter the circumstances. Next page there, Matthew 16. Now, Mark 16. I thought about this and I thought, I'm kind of trying to make it shorter, but I can't. I look back last year, I believe it was last year. I actually did Resurrection Sunday. And then I did Resurrection Part 2 the next Sunday, because there's so much information and so many great and wonderful things that we get because he died and rose again. But we'll see if we will repeat that performance this year. But Mark 16, the other thing I thought about, let me get there. How many times have we heard this story? If you've been in church for, let's say, 5 years, you've heard at least 5 times. Been in church. Watch your step, okay. Or if you've been in church for 20 years, you've heard it at least 20 times. You know, you kind of get the idea. You heard it at least many more times than that, but at least once a year. And so that's where we get all clever and think, well, we got to dress it up. And the Lord just said, no, just tell the story. Tell him about Jesus. Tell him who he is. Tell him he is the one that was prophesied about. Several hundred years, thousands of years before. Just tell them. Now, when the Sabbath was passed, why did they roll the stone up there? Why did they walk away? Because it was the Sabbath coming, and they could not do any work. So the plan was to go back and anoint the body with the spices and all those things that you would do, basically what we would call maybe an embalming, okay, but preparing the body for death. Now, when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. Early morning, all right? And when they said among themselves, "Who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us?" What was their expectation? He's dead. He's dead. It's over. We're going to fulfill our duties and go and anoint the body for permanent burial. That was their expectation. What was the disciples' expectation? They're gone. One was there. John was there at the cross. And the other 10 were gone. So, what were they expecting? What we would expect in the natural, but we have a supernatural God. And that's why you never quit praying for people. Who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us? And when they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed." I don't know how many times in Scripture it says, "Do not be afraid, do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified." They saw it. They heard him say, "It is finished." They saw him breathe his last. They saw the blood. They saw the when he threw the spear into his side and the blood and the water flowed from his body and it was lifeless and they just took him off of the cross and just drops. They saw all that. That's got to be, that's one of those things in your mind that'll be there forever. I was there. Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified, past tense. He is risen. Hallelujah. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. Because are you going to believe him? Hey, this is a pretty amazing guy sitting there all glowing, all white and everything, angelic. But he said, "You're looking in the wrong place. Why are you looking," in Luke it says, "why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's not here. He is risen." And then if that wasn't enough, he goes, "Come here, I'm going to show you." He was right there, wasn't he? Weren't you here when they brought him in? Yeah, we were here. He's not there. Proof, evidence, so that when they go, and that's exactly what he tells them to do, go tell his disciples. And why does he say, "and Peter"? Because Peter was the most discouraged. Peter's the one that denied him 3 times. He said, "Make sure you tell Peter." There's a message right there. That's why I said it's really difficult to try and capitalize this in a message. But no matter what you have done, Jesus is still wanting to see you. Isn't that good? He denied him 3 times. Went out and wept bitterly, it says, about Peter. No. And make sure, tell the disciples, the 10. Remember, Judas is gone. There was 12. Now we're down to 11. Just doing the math for you. And make sure you tell Peter. Do you think God feels it when we hurt? Of course he does. He knows the heart. Sorry, leaving, chasing rabbits. Here we go. All right, come back. Go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him, as he said to you. So they went out quickly and fled from the tomb, for they trembled, they were amazed, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is a life-changing moment, isn't it? What my little brain and my emotions would be. Everything I'd hoped was in this man. Three and a half years we followed him. We believed everything. We saw the miracles. We saw the five loaves and the, you know, the two fish or whatever it is. And he brought three people out of the grave. There was the widow of Nain's son. There was the little girl, Jairus' daughter. And then, of course, there was Lazarus. So why, you know, when they mocked him at the cross, they're thinking, he saved others. He must not be who he says he is because he can't save himself. Well, he didn't come to save himself. He came to save us. And so all this emotion was there. There's a hymn in the hymnal. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? They were there. They saw him in the tomb, and they're crushed, and they've only had about 24 hours because Sabbath they took off because you can't do any work on the Sabbath. And just the grief and the pain. And then you show up at a tomb, and they go, he's not here. He's gone. And you got to be thinking in your mind, somebody stole the body, right? Because I live in the natural. God lives in the supernatural. So they're trying to filter all this. And of course, if we were to read all the Gospels, we would find that when they went to tell the disciples about Jesus being raised from the dead, and they what? They didn't believe the women. They didn't believe him. They said, sounded like nonsense. It wasn't. So we have the story. Now, here's where we want to begin to look at the resurrection. There in your notes. The resurrection of Jesus Christ means that believers are justified before God. That's a big word. Justified. All right. Here's the verse, Romans 4:25. He was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. And right underneath of it, I figured, why not just stick it in there? Justification means to be put right with. We were put right with God. We were separated from God. And our sin separated us from God. Isaiah 59. Your sin separates you from God. And all of a sudden, we are in right standing with God. Not because of what we did, but because of what Christ did. Remember, this is about Jesus. And we go, we are the beneficiaries of what he did. It's kind of like he wrote a will. And he says, and these are my beneficiaries. All those who believe are beneficiaries. Where do you cash that check in heaven? Isn't that good? In the death of Jesus Christ on the what? Cross. This isn't hard. God put our punishment on Christ so that we could be justified before him. So that we could. He put it on him. We've talked about this many times. All of the wrath that was due for all mankind, for all time, it's a check bigger than the U.S. national debt, all right? So that's big. It's huge. And we couldn't pay it. And he did it so that we could stand with the Lord. The resurrection of Jesus confirms that God accepted Christ sacrifice for sin on the cross gives us access to a right relationship with him. Now that might seem like a big deal to us, but we know this. If you're a Jew, They had the Day of Atonement, Leviticus 16. And you could, the high priest could go in once a year into the, and the presence of God would show up. But when Christ dies on the cross and allows us to see the Father at any time we want to. And how do you go in? Just like you are. Go back and read that and see how they prepared to go in just to spend a few moments in the Holy of Holies, in the presence of God. The sacrifices were made, the washings that were made. But now, because of what Christ did on the cross, we can go anytime. We don't have to do that. Our cleansing came then. When I believed that Christ died on the cross for my sin, I was cleansed. I don't have to keep washing my hands. I don't have to keep repeating or sacrifices and things like that, sacrificing animals. We are justified because of what Christ did. The resurrection of Jesus Christ shows that Jesus defeated death. That's kind of important. That's very important. I don't want to discourage you, but unless there's a rapture, you're going to die. No! Yes, you are. I am too. I'm not making plans. I haven't set the date or anything. I haven't sent out the invitations yet for the funeral. But there are no invitations, is there? Okay. Good. Because that'll be one more thing I'll never do. Okay. I'm going to. He said, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. It's defeated. Don't worry about it. When you take out, and if we really could, and I don't know that we will until we walk through the gate of heaven, but if we could really totally get rid of that fear, what else can hurt you? What else can stop me from being bold in my faith? If I'm not afraid of dying, you can't do anything to me. In this day and age, you need that kind of courage. You need that kind of faith. I've thought about this a lot. I think, and I know I've probably shared this, every generation, from your great-great-great-great-great-great-great-great-grandparents all the way up all those generations, every generation probably said about their kids, it's worse now than it's ever been. And then we get the next generation, it's worse now than it's ever been. And then we got to the 60s and we had this guy named Elvis going, ooh. And they went, wow, this is terrible. This is the worst thing I've ever seen. And you know what? I think this is the worst we've ever seen. I do. We have so far passed, and you can look this up and check me. It's Isaiah 5:20, I believe. We call evil good and good evil. It's amazing the day we live in. So I need to know that I am right with God. I don't have, now it doesn't mean I'm rude to people, but it does mean that if I'm secure in God, that's the security I need. My security cannot be found out there in the media or social media or wherever. Well, I think I'm important because I got 3 likes when I put out the picture of my cat. That doesn't get you there. It's because of what Christ did. Yeah, but I bought slippers from the My Pillow guy. That should get me in. No, nay. It's what Christ did. It's overcoming death. Christ, let me say this, because I don't think I'm cold. I've cried a lot of funerals. A lot. It hurts. The separation is painful. But down underneath all of that pain and that suffering is the hope of heaven. The security that we know where we're going. As the old cliche, you breathe your last here, you breathe your first in heaven. You're there. Twinkling of an eye. Boom. Christ rose from the dead because death could no longer hold him. We no longer have to fear death. because Christ has triumphed over it. Think about identifying with Christ. If death could not hold him, death will not hold you. That's good to know. I have a lie once in a while over the top, and I apologize sometimes, sense of humor. But I would love to put a microphone or a speaker in my casket with a recording. Hey, how you doing? I'm doing great. Just wanted you to know I'm okay. Wouldn't that freak people out? But I will be. And all those who believe will be. And again, this is not arrogance. This is not pride. I didn't do it. I didn't pay for it. Christ did. He wants you to have that feeling of security. Don't be afraid. 3, the resurrection of Jesus Christ means that believers are united with Christ. We believe in Christ. We are united to him, should say by faith, in faith. United with him. We're going to get to what that means. Let's just jump on through this. Union with Christ means that when God looks at us, he does not see our unrighteousness, but the righteousness of Christ. I am clothed with the purity and the holiness of Christ. And so when in Matthew 7, one of the scariest verses in the Bible to me is about people arriving at the gate and he goes, I don't know you. Why? Because they did not have the presence of Christ upon them. And so it's not hard. There's no questions. I don't know you. You're not dressed, as God would say, you're not dressed in my son Jesus. You're not clothed with his righteousness. You have not been justified because you did not believe. It means that we have died with him. We will also live with him. Romans 6:8. Isn't that good to know? We are now, let's keep walking here. I just gave you the word. We are now able to walk in newness of life because we are bound to Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit. Keep your eyes on Christ. The idea, this is so simple, come on, you can do this. This idea is shown in baptism, which is the physical demonstration of the spiritual reality, our dying with Christ and being raised with him. You ever been to a baptism? You ever seen one on TV? Whatever, I don't know. Little House on the Prairie or something? Take them in, take them down to the water, represents your identification with Christ and his death. You come up out of the water to show, I am also risen with Christ, and I now walk in the purity and the holiness of God. Keep your eyes on Christ. Hebrews 12 says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorned its shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so you'll never grow weary and lose heart. Keep your eyes on him. Keep your eyes on Christ. The resurrection. Number 4, the resurrection of Jesus Christ proves the gospel to be true. Come back to that in a second. Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15. And if Christ has not been raised, he's making an argument in 1 Corinthians 15, because there's people who don't believe in the resurrection. And so he says, well, okay, here's how it works. If Christ has not been raised and our preaching is in vain, your faith is in vain. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. That's not good news. Then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, We are of all people most to be pitied. But we are going to see him beyond this life. He was resurrected, praise God. He was brought up from the grave. And so Paul's just making a rhetorical point. You know, he's not looking for an answer here. He's just saying, look, you don't believe? You don't get. You know, this isn't in your notes, but I did mention Lazarus a little bit ago. Lazarus was a very good friend of Jesus, and he died. And we all know the story. It's John 11. And they came and they said he was sick, and then they waited, and the disciples couldn't figure all that out. And so they wait, and it's 4 days, and he goes. And he calls, he gets there, and they go, he's been dead 4 days, don't mess with him. But Jesus asked a question. He says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. And what did he end that sentence with? Do you believe this? That's the key. Do you believe this? Do you believe that Christ died on a cross? Do you believe that they took him down off of that cross and they put him in a tomb and they rolled a stone in front of it? And then on the third day that after he was declared dead, when they opened it up, he wasn't there. Do you believe that? Do you believe he was resurrected? That's why Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. And though you die, you will live. Do you believe this? That's the question everybody here has to answer. Do you believe that? Is that real to you? Does that help you make up your mind about Christ? This is the story. This is the one who fulfilled prophecy. This is the one who walked this life out, who did the miracles, who raised people from the dead, who spoke marvelous words, teachings that people said, wow, this is beyond anything we've ever heard. Who stood fast to the end and completed the Father's mission. The one who went to Gethsemane and prayed and cried and came out victorious. It's him. It's him. It's true. Now, 5 on the back page. The resurrection of Jesus Christ means that God the Father will give his Holy Spirit to believers. When Jesus died, before he died, when before he ascended to heaven in Acts chapter 1, he told him, he said, you guys go awake, the Holy Spirit's coming. I will send you a comforter. I will send you a helper. I will send you one who will teach you all things that I have told you and remind you. The Holy Spirit will come. He doesn't leave you helpless or hopeless. He didn't just go, okay, now you all believe and hang on till you die. He didn't do that. He empowered us to live out this life for those who believe. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? The resurrection of Jesus Christ means God the Father will give his Holy Spirit to believers. And only to believers. You got to ask. You got to confess. After Christ has risen and ascended, he sent the promised Holy Spirit to continue his work on earth. When Jesus said it was finished, the payment was made for sin for all time. There's still people to bring in. There's still people out there to bring in. There's still people to tell. His work was done. Everything he was going to do, he did it. He gave you the gift of eternal life. Here, take it. This means that Christ's earthly ministry continues today through his people, or you could say through his church, in whom he dwells by the Holy Spirit. This is how I want to finish up, because this is one of my many concerns, especially in the day we live. Romans 8, if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, it's if he also raised Christ who living in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of the Spirit who lives in you. I will give you life. I will give you life abundant. I will give you the teacher, the comforter, the strength, the courage, the faith. I will give you everything. I will give you the fruit of the Spirit, the love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. I'll give it all. You get it all. It's a package. You get it. Paul in Philippians 3, I want to know Christ. The sign of a true believer is I want to know Christ and I want to continue to grow in that knowledge. That's a sign you're born again. If you don't want to know, you have no interest, you have no hunger for the word, I would go back to the Lord and say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I believe in what Jesus Christ did on the cross. And I want him to be Lord in my life. Come into my life. I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings. Oh, I get them both. Becoming like him in his death and somehow attaining the resurrection from the dead. I want to go back. I want to know the power of his resurrection. He didn't leave you powerless. He didn't leave you hopeless. Paul in Romans, what a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Remember? Death. What did Christ overcome? Death. Who's going to do it? Jesus. Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. Just nailing down the end of the gospel right there. It is because of what he did. If Jesus had not risen from the dead, we would never have heard of him. Would you? If there's no resurrection, there's no reason to go on with his story. His story dies with him. But the very fact that he was raised from the dead, his story lives on. His spirit keeps moving. His kingdom is growing. Now, here's what I want you to do, because in case you're ever tempted to think, well, I don't know. Right there it says your name. Okay, that means you have to write your name in there. When Mary and them came to the grave, and the angel said, he's not here. When Satan comes to tempt you with something from years past, you just go, that guy died. He's not here anymore. He's risen to walk a new life. That's not me. That might have been me, but it's not me now. I don't live there. I've moved. I live in the kingdom of God. My old address. If you want to get hold of me, it's a forwarding address, you know. I live in the kingdom now. It's not here. I have risen to new life. I am now empowered by his Holy Spirit to be the overcoming conqueror that he's called me to be. One more verse that's not in your notes, Galatians 2:20. We share it often, but it just, I have been crucified with Christ, Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. So that goes back to, I'm not here. I've risen to a new life. I've been crucified with Christ. I no longer live. Christ lives in me. The life I now live in this body, in this city, in this house, with these people, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. So I have to have Christ. I can never do enough to be considered the righteousness of God. He is risen. Now, a little exercise, and we're almost done here. See, I should have started the service this way. See, I'm supposed to say something, you're supposed to say something. You ready? He has risen.
He has risen.
He has risen.
He has
risen. There you go. That's the confession. It's a good confession. Today you can make a great exchange. You can take all your sadness, your sorrow, and your defeats, your doubts, and trade them for hope, joy, and the power of Christ. You need that. Christianity is not just I know it's called a religion, it's not just a religion. It's a new life. It's an empowered life. It's a life of truth and love, joy, and peace, forgiveness, and grace. And we can have it because he died for us. Let's pray. Father, we believe, we're going to go back to John 11 all of a sudden here, Lord. I just feel like we need to see it. Do you believe this? Do you believe that Christ died for you? Do you believe that he lived a fulfillment of prophecy? He was a man that walked this earth and he walked it sinless and he died on a cross and he paid the price for our sin. And we were separated from God because of that sin. And now I have been brought close. Do you believe this? If I believe this, then do I live this? Father, I want to say thank you for your word. Thank you for your helping us understand. Thank you, Father, no matter how I can convolute things sometimes, that you make it make sense. And so I thank you, Lord. On this day, the greatest day in world history, hallelujah, hallelujah, life, humanity was changed. It's changed forever. Christ died for us. And he rose again, giving us victory over sin, no fear of hell, and no fear of death. Thank you. Father, I'm going to pray too that we are empowered by your Spirit, that we realize you have given us your Holy Spirit that indwells us. And we say thank you. And I would hope we can all say, I believe this. I believe. I believe. Father, on a day to celebrate the life, the resurrected life of Christ, we sometimes still have our struggles. We still have our doubts and our fears. We have our battles. And so, Father, on this day, I'm moved by your Spirit. If anyone needs a prayer of agreement, just somebody to come alongside and say, let's pray together. Father, you will move them forward as we end this service, closing worship, and that everyone can leave saying, I believe this. I believe this. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. It's pretty straightforward. The worship team will come and lead us. It is a worship song, so please enjoy the worship. Worship your God. And if during this worship song you want prayer for anything in your life, any struggle, battle, whatever's going on, or maybe today you couldn't say, I believe this, but now you can. You come forward and we'll meet you at the front. You come as the Holy Spirit leads you.
For time of response, we're going to sing Jesus Paid It All. If everybody could please stand.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small, child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all and all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin and left a crimson stain, Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. stand incomplete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.
Thank you, Father, for the song as we becomes a confession. He's taken my sin. He's washed me. I am justified. If you keep using those words, I'm sanctified. Some one day I'm glorified. I'm saved. Thank you, Lord, for your love. Thank you for this day, the most important day of our year. The celebration of our risen Lord. We thank you. Thank you for the gift you gave us that day. The gift of your Spirit, the gift of eternal life, the gift of the knowledge of who you are, the gift of faith, the gift of hope. We thank you. Lord, as we leave this place, my prayer remains the same. When Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life. And though you die, you will live. Do you believe this? That we can say, I believe this. Thank you again, Lord, for your love, your peace upon the households here. And as we gather with families this day, there'll be joy, there'll be laughter, healing, and hope. In the name of Jesus we go. Amen. Amen.